And we're live at Cousins Gymnasium. I'm Alex Dobian, joined by Bernie Birnbaum for an afternoon of NESCAC basketball featuring the Tufts Jumbos and the Wesleyan Cardinals. How are you doing today, Bernie?
I'm pretty good. You know, we had a whole pregame show already for you, and then we encountered some last-minute technical difficulties, so even the best of plans fail. It's already time for the national anthem, but we're going to try and bring you some of that content throughout the game, and otherwise, well, it was for our own benefit.
It was an exciting contest yesterday. We hope you could have joined us to see Conn against Tufts as the national anthem begins here at Cousins Gymnasium.
Alex, you just mentioned the Tufts game last night. They defeated Connecticut College pretty handily. We don't have a lot of time to recap, but we do have some plays to show you from last night.
I'm going to start with the starting lineups first for Wesleyan.
First here you can see a breakaway and a dunk coming from...
That's Vincent Pace with the jam.
And then this is a sequence of back-to-back three-pointers. That's from Haladena.
Tri-captain making the three and then stealing the ball on the Conn College inbounds and hit another pull-up three-pointer.
Back to tonight's game.
Real quick for the Wesleyan Cardinals starting lineup, it's Rashid Epps, Joseph Kuo, BJ Davis, Harry Rafferty, and Jack Mack. You're going to be starting for your Wesleyan Cardinals.
Yeah, Rafferty didn't start last night, but he was the leading scorer and often is the leading scorer for the Cardinals. Didn't start this afternoon.
For Tufts, starting it's number one, Thomas Lapham. Next up is going to be the big star for Tufts so far. Stepping up is Tom Pelleschi, the sophomore. Tallest player on the court at 6'8", the most jumbo of the jumbos. Next up, it's going to be number three, Ryan Spatterford, junior guard. Number five, Ben Ferris, had a big game yesterday, able to contribute a couple of threes. Some nice dishes.
Yeah, he led all scores. Well, he led the jumbos with 14 points last night.
Last but not least, it's Drew Masden filling in for the injured Hunter Civetti.
So it's the same lineup we saw yesterday from the Jumbos, a slightly different lineup than Cardinals fans will have seen last night with Rafferty coming in. The Cardinals suffered a tough loss last night. They scored more points from the field than the Bobcats, but were done away by their tendency for turnovers, and they also committed 21 fouls to Bates 12, which got the Bobcats to the line. The Bobcats had 10 more free throw makes than the Cardinals, and in an 8-point game, that was the difference. One of the keys to the game for Wesleyan is going to be smart play. Not committing unnecessary fouls, staying smart with the ball, and not committing turnovers.
Head coach for Wesleyan, Joe Riley, is going to hope they can run a tighter game, cut down on those mistakes if they want to win today, this afternoon, at Cousins Gymnasium. We go to center court for the tip. It's Pelleschi sizing up Joseph Kuo as we get underway here.
A battle of 6'8 Titans. Kuo wins the tip.
Jack Mackey brings it up the court. Goes for the drive. Opts not to take the shot. Here's Kuo. He's off the mark. It's going to be a Tufts rebound. They'll get their first possession of the game. The freshman, Lapham, who's been starting the last couple of games for the Jumbos, is bringing it down the court. Lapham finds Pelleschi. Takes a dribble, turns around. Hits a nice little lefty one-hander.
And already he's equaled his total field goals from last night.
Going to want to use those low post moves in the absence of Sabetti. They're going to rely on Pelleschi down low. Here's B.J. Davis. Passes it to Mackey. Gets the pick from Epps. Davis thinks about the long two, but opts not to go for it. And Pelleschi clogging the lane, able to force a Wesleyan turnover.
Wesleyan's a team that relies heavily on incredible three-point shooting. On the first few possessions, Jumbos have been guarding the outside.
Ferris takes the long two. It's going to knock off the rim and to a Wesleyan player.
I think Epps might have been knocked in the face on that play. He's wiping off his eye.
Edmonds finds Mackey. Davis. Here's Rashid Epps, and he's got the first points of the match for your Wesleyan Cardinals. Lapham leading the offense for the Jumbos. Pelleschi's got it on the block. Spatterford trying to find Pelleschi. Ends up with the outside shot. It doesn't go. It's going to be a Wesleyan rebound. And real quick, there's a three-pointer there from Mackey, who spotted up. Didn't get it. Epps was able to find... Sorry, it was Joseph Kuo who was able to find the rebound, but he wasn't able to find the basket. It's going to remain a 2-2 contest. Here's Lapham again, who finds Spatterford. To Ben Ferris. Around the perimeter to Spatterford, who finds Pelleschi, and it's going to be off of...
It went off of Spatterford's knee.
It's going to be a Wesleyan inbound. Taking the ball up the court, that's B.J. Davis. Last week he was NESCAC Player of the Week. On a hot streak, though he struggled in yesterday's game against Bates. Shooting-wise, still notched 11 assists. With the three, it's Mackey. Gets a couple of unlucky bounces. Refs are going to say that it was last touched by Joseph Kuo.
Hey, you could see players from both teams are trying to keep their hands off the ball as it went out of bounds. Both sides thought the other had the last touch.
Lapham demonstrating his handles. Davis stares him down, but it's going to be a turnover forced by Joe Edmonds to Mackey. And Pelleschi is going to swat away the entry pass.
Early on, it's very interesting to watch the matchup between Kuo and Pelleschi, the two 6'8 players on the floor. Both are probably not used to having a player similar height on the court at the same time.
Pelleschi's probably missing Sabetti, who's out for injury reasons. Still unclear to us what has happened to him, but looks like some sort of a leg or knee injury as he was sitting on the brace on the sideline. Referee whistles a foul. It's going to go against Tufts.
Ladies and gentlemen, the president has entered the building, Tony Monaco of Tufts University, fashionably late to this evening's game.
Wesleyan shot is off the mark. Lapham marshals the offense.
So we've had 4 points in as many minutes, a very low-scoring game early on, and this will favor the Jumbos. The Jumbos have the lowest-scoring offense in NESCAC, but have won games with their lockdown defense. Wesleyan, on the other hand, is a much higher-scoring team.
Pelleschi with the turnaround. Jay doesn't get it to go. Rebounded by Epps. Series of passes around the wings. finds the ball in B.J. Davis's hands and back to Mackey. He's going to penetrate. The rim protector, Pelleschi, forces a miss, but Joseph Kuo is going to be there for the putback.
And it's about time. The Jumbos trail for the first time this weekend.
Wesleyan a high-scoring team, but they're also giving up 75 points a game. That's second worst in the NESCAC. With the shot from Vincent Pace, who hits the corner three. From the right angle of the rectangle that forms this basketball court is a Vincent Pace three to make it a 5-4 Jumbos lead. Picking up the scoring here. Mackey hits an outside shot of his own to make it 7-5.
Mackey is one of three starters for the Cardinals that averages over 35% from three-point land. Very impressive array of outside shooting.
An athletic play from Jack Mackey sees him swat the ball out of bounds to thwart that pass from Lapham. Going to be a couple of substitutions. Ben Engvall is going to enter the game for the Jumbos along with Tariq Smith. Both key contributors, especially Smith, who had went on a scoring tear earlier this month with 18 and 20-point games against Amherst and Middlebury. Smith finds Vincent Pace. Ball got a little slippery there for Pace, who couldn't manage to keep a handle on it. Engvall's pass to Pelleschi is stolen by double zero, Rashid Epps.
And Pelleschi doing well to keep the pressure on and allow his teammates to get back on defense.
Mackey with the drive. He's swarmed by a couple of Jumbos. Vincent Pace attempted the steal. Couldn't quite get it. Mackey is going to find Harry Rafferty before taking a three. Rebounded by Rashid Epps. His layup is no good. Zebras are going to call it a jumbo ball.
There hasn't been much of a break in the action yet. Very fast-paced start through the first six-plus minutes.
Still hasn't resulted in much scoring for either team as we see a drive from Stephen Halladina, who gets the whistle. Looks like the he's going to go to the line.
Returning for Wesleyan, number four.
He was not an active shooting, just an inbounds coming out from Smith.
I'm going to say it was before the shot. Smith to inbound. He's got Halladina. Tariq Smith is going to reset this Tufts half-court offense.
Now Pelleschi coming out of the game at the same time as Kuo. I'm not sure if either coach is going to allow the other team's big man to be on the floor without his own.
Halladina had the open tray after the cross-court pass, but couldn't get it to go. Wesleyan's going to charge back down the court. With the Band-Aid, that's Joe Edmonds, who is able to find Harry Rafferty. Davis and Rafferty can't decide who should keep the ball, but eventually it winds up in the hands of Edmonds.
Oh. There's a significant amount of contact there. I think Vincent Pace went back to his childhood on a leapfrog over an unwilling opponent.
That was Tim Gallivan, the senior backup power forward for the Cardinals, who was fouled. In the corner, it's going to be Edmonds. No good. Here's Tariq Smith getting the pick from Engvall. Isn't going to result in any sort of action, but Halladina with the drive launches the floater from 7 or 8 feet, but off the backboard and into the wings of a Wesleyan Cardinal.
Pace got a hand on that one.
Wasn't enough. And Davis able to get the jumper to go.
Cardinals now have the Jumbos doubled up, 10-5.
Smith's drive finds an opening for a layup. As Halladina fails to make the steal there, despite the athletic attempt. Davis finds Edmonds. Gets the pick to open up some space, but it's going to be Ben Engvall who managed to wrestle the ball from his opposite counterpart from Wesleyan. It looked like it was Joe Edmonds that he was able to wrest the ball from. Smith with the three. It's going to be rebounded by Drew Mazin, who's able to follow up with another two-point attempt there that goes.
Well, I don't think you can get an assist on a rebound. And Piss should get one for that play coming out of nowhere to tip the ball to his teammate.
Swinging it around the wing is Wesleyan. Edmonds finds Gallivan, who finds the long two from just beyond the foul line.
It takes guts to take that shot. It's not particularly open. Plenty of time on the shot clock. Just took a shot that you don't often see taken.
It's point in time. Tufts a little bit undersized compared to the Wesleyan players that are on the floor as Pace misses the inner city. With the big drive, it's going to be Joe Edmonds who powers his way past a couple of Tufts defenders to make it 14-9. We're nearing the halfway mark of this first. Smith to Pace. Finds Halladina, the tri-captain. Pace distance back to Halladina after seeing some particularly tall Wesleyan Cardinals standing in his way. And while unintimidated by the double team,
Coach
makes
Sheldon,
the drive and gets fouled.
Coach Sheldon may want to consider, and he is, as Quo and Pelleschi both coming back in, is about to say he should consider getting some size back on the court.
He's going to do so.
Returning to the Jumbos lineup, number two.
Tom Pelleschi re-entering the game.
Returning for Wesleyan.
And alongside Quo, I didn't catch who came to the scorers table first, but can't imagine there'll be a moment where only one of them is on the floor. Unless somebody fouls out.
Smith swings it around to Pace, who's got Pelleschi on the block. He likes to play with his back to the basket. With a powerful pass to Ben Engvall.
Engvall was a little sloppy. He briefly lost a handle and should put it up and draw a foul. It's a little over halfway through the period. No timeouts yet.
Hopefully this game picks up in pace.
Picks up. I don't know if it could get much faster.
Entering the game for the Jumbos, number 20, Stefan Duvivier.
From a scoring perspective, we still have a long ways to go as Engvall makes his first shot from the foul line.
Yeah, even Tufts' low-scoring team in NESCAC averages over 65 points a game. They're on pace for about 40.
Both foul shots made by Engvall to cut it to a three-point contest. Davis takes on Smith. They're going to work it to Kuo down low. Neither the original shot nor the putback were able to go, and Zebras are going to whistle.
Tufts foul is on number two.
Some incriminating hand signals from the referee indicating a foul on the Tufts Jumbos.
The fouling in this game so far has been smart fouling. There have been no unnecessary fouls. Situational. Sometimes you got to do what you got to do. And as Quill makes the first, if he wasn't fouled, there would have been two on the board for sure.
Entering the game for Wesleyan, number five.
Another pair of foul shots made, this time by
Jack Mackey.
Wesley's Joseph Quill. Smith marshals the Tufts offense once again. Swarmed by a couple of Wesleyan defenders, he finds Engvall in the corner. There's Stefan Duvivier. Back to Smith. Tries to shake the defender, but opts to go for the pass to Halladina, whose shot is off the mark. pulling up for the three. That is good from P.J. Reed.
It's the largest lead of the game for either team as Cardinals are up 19-11. That three attempt had a lot of airtime.
Tufts is going to want to crack down on the perimeter defense as Smith is fouled on his way to the basket. He's going to shoot a couple of shots.
Wesleyan fouls on Harry Rafferty. His first personal fourth team foul. Curry Smith at the line. Two shots.
Smith makes his first foul shot of the game.
Replacing Stephen Halladiga. Timeout, Wesleyan.
And we're going to have a timeout called by Wesleyan coach Joe Riley.
Well, as I mentioned in the pregame, we had some stuff prepared for you. At this point in the game, it might not be as relevant, but you might want to take a look at the Tufts keys to the game. Unfortunately, we continue to have some technical difficulties, so no communication between us and the director, but we can go over them without the graphics. So what we were saying before the game, Jumbos need to be able to guard the perimeter shot.
Also going to need some strong bench play coming from these players who are replacing the injured Hunter Sabetti. And last but not least, going to be able to defend the perimeter and not give up so many three-pointers. Unsuccessful so far for Tufts, who have allowed a couple of three-point shots.
Yeah, 3 of 7 is par for the course for the Cardinals. That's how they've done so far.
Relatively strong shooting percentage. Respectable at the very least from Wesleyan.
Well, that's just from three-point land. It's 43%.
Davis finds Jordan Sears. Freshman struggling to shake Duvivier. Gets it to Joseph Kuo, who's called for a travel. Unable to get around Pelleschi without taking an extra step. Gonna have a Jumbo basketball once again. Davis staring down Smith. Finds Ben Ferris. And goes back to Duvivier. Unable to penetrate so far. Pelleschi finds himself surrounded by a couple defenders from Wesleyan. Opts to go for the pick. And Engvall takes it down the lane and is able to find the right side of the hoop. A quick response from Wesleyan. Sees Mackey pass it inside, but has his entry pass swiped by Ben Engvall. Smith on the wing to Duvivier, who finds Ben Ferris, whose defender Jordan Sears trailed him for a half second before catching up. Pelleschi with the turnaround lefty doesn't get that shot to go. Was able to hit it earlier in the game.
Pelleschi this weekend has not been strong from the field, only 1 for 8 last night, but made up for it by hitting a bunch of free throws.
Engvall is a little late to rotate over. Duvivier attempted the swipe. It's going to result in the foul.
That's his first personal fourth team foul.
And P.J. Reed is going to go to the line for Wesleyan.
With his two shots.
No red sneakers there. Makes the first.
You mentioned the sneakers. What's slightly interesting about this game is Cardinals are wearing home whites on the road and the Jumbos on their away solids and their baby blue. Every once in a while they'll change it up like that.
Both foul shots are able to go for P.J. Reed. You might see shots of the Wesleyan bench. They've got their solid red warm-up saying, "We do," a very nice look, very spiffy for players unable to enter the game. Pelleschi with the outside shot, knocks it down.
If I'm not mistaken, that's his third three-pointer of the season. It's not something he does very often. Certainly not something the Cardinals suspected.
It's rare to see him straying outside the arc. Normally prefers to stay closer to the block with the back to the basket, but you see him making the steal there, making a big impact on this game so far for the Jumbos.
A series of unfortunate events for both teams. Quo first lost the ball, Pelleschi got it, then lost by Smith, and now in the Cardinal possession to foul.
Big block there by Pelleschi, and a lot of contact. It looks like Jordan Sears is shaking up a little bit.
That's his second personal, fifth team foul.
Not sure if the injury there was physical or mental, because that rejection is going to produce some anguish even as he goes to the line. First shot by Sears is good. Lapham is going to enter the game for the Jumbos, as well as Tim Gallivan for Wesleyan, scurrying to the line to see if he can get the rebound of Sears' second shot, should he miss, which he does not, sinking both of them. Good foul shooting so far from both teams.
Not a single miss. That's something I often find myself talking about at these is poor free throw shooting. Not tonight.
Lapham with some energetic dribbling. Able to find Ryan Spatterford in the corner for another three. Tufts is going into a two-point contest after trailing by eight just a couple of minutes ago.
Well, this has definitely been one of the more exciting games we've seen played here at Cousins Gymnasium.
Here's
at least
Joe
this
Edmonds.
Season.
He only finds Davis, who swings it out to Sears, whose three-pointer is not going to go. Pelleschi and Spatterford battling for the rebound before realizing they were wearing the same color jersey.
What we see now is Spatterford on the floor, unopposed by Kuo, so the Jumbos have the size advantage.
Ferris cuts to the top of the key, takes the pass from Lapton, and promptly sinks a jumper to tie this game at 23. And we're going to get a Wesleyan timeout in response to this tough run.
Well, it's been very impressive, and the crowd here is very excited. It's a larger crowd than we had here last night.
Don't let President Tony Monaco see on your screen now dissuade you. The crowd here is really getting into it, despite Tony's normally cool demeanor.
There's a replay of the steal and then prompt turnover by Smith. The Cardinals able to turn that possession into a couple of free throws.
Getting a little frantic here.
My guess is on that play, Sears just had the wind knocked out of him. We saw that happen in one of the women's games last week, and it's not a serious injury, you just need a moment. That looks like that's what happened.
Speaking of the women, for those of you who follow NESCAC basketball closely, you'll know that the women and men play at the same time, usually against the same teams, but in opposite gymnasiums, so your Tufts Jumbos are going to be taking on Wesleyan at Wesleyan today in Middletown, Connecticut.
It's a new format this season. Most aficionados of college basketball are used to the doubleheader format where one team, typically the women's team, will play first and then the men's team will follow. The two teams will travel together. This year, for whatever reason, NESCAC decided to change it up. What that means for us here is we have pretty much every weekend covered between the men and the women. Somebody's usually home.
That game starts at 3 o'clock. As it gets going, we'll be sure to bring you some scores in the second half as play restarts with a Wesleyan inbound. Epps with the pick. Davis and Epps with a little handoff. Finally, another player gets involved for Wesleyan. That's Mackey, who's unable to keep a handle on the ball. Both Spatterford and Madsden were covering him there with some fervor. He lost his cool for a little bit, and the ball spilled out of bounds. Lapham to Engvall. A little pick and pop, and a handoff to Ferris, whose three-pointer is not good there.
Madsen didn't even try to get that rebound. Maybe it's not in the line that he could get.
Maggie finds a cutting back in the back door. Edmonds, who's fouled on his way to the hoop.
At this point, with just over 4 minutes of play, I want to remind you that you can interact with us on social media. Feel free to like our Facebook page and tweet us, either at JumboCast, Tufts JumboCast, that is, or using the hashtag Tufts JumboCast. We answer any and all tweets at halftime.
First foul shot is going to be off the mark for Joe Edmonds. That's the first missed free throw of the game.
Also at halftime, we're going to send one of our intrepid camera women down to the track and field meet. It's going on at the other end of this athletics complex, and we're going to get you some live footage from that, and maybe even show you some of the Quidditch practice that's going on behind us. It's a busy day.
Lapham finds Engvall here as we resume coverage of the game, being temporarily distracted by telling you about all the internet goings-on. Lapham can't shake Davis, but he can find Ben Ferris, who gets it to Madsden with some smooth dishing in the low post to get Ben Engvall open for a layup.
Swishing and dishing is what Clyde Frazier says.
There's no swishing or dishing there on that play. Mostly just collisions between Engvall and Joe Edmonds. Engvall's going to be whistled for the foul. They're going to say he was in the act of shooting here. Correction, he's... Wesleyan is in the bonus for the first time after a couple of Tufts fouls. Misses the first of the 1-1.
We're starting to see some of those free throw misses that pain me so much, but both teams well over 70% free throw shooting, and in NESCAC, that's nothing to complain about.
Engvall to Spatterford. Head fakes before settling on a long two. Looked like his foot was on the line. Rebounded by Madsden. Ben Ferris is open at the top of the key, and it's good with...
Very good ball movement is how Ferris ended up getting open, but a foul, a loose ball foul at the end of the play. It was against Wesleyan, so Tufts will maintain possession. This is the first example of the lapse I think we've seen from the Cardinals. It doomed them last night, and now in a four-point hole.
And on the inbound pass, it winds up to in Spatterford's hands, and he's fouled.
Well, halftime can't come quickly enough for the Cardinals, who after being up eight, now trail by four and have made two consecutive fouls, and not good fouls. As I said earlier, all the fouls that have been made to that point were smart fouls, necessary fouls, not the case the past couple seconds.
Spatterford sinks the first. Tufts displaying some gaudy free throw shooting stats so far this game. And he gets the second to rumble through the hoop. BJ Davis is going to bring it up the court. Finds the star center, Joseph Kuo, and they're going to get whistled for a foul here. It looks like it was off the ball. We're going to see another Wesleyan 1-1.
Joe Edmonds, shooting, 1-1.
The Oklahoma City native, Joe Edmonds, going to the line. Wonder if he's adopted the Thunder as his team in recent years. Got a couple Midwesterners on this Wesleyan squad. Harry Rafferty is from Dubuque, Iowa. J.R. Baskin from Minnesota. And from Olathe, Kansas, Davis Reed, the sophomore at number 10.
I didn't know there were people in Iowa.
Every 4 years. With 3 minutes and 4 seconds left, Engvall inbounds to Tariq Smith. Madsden pick, hedged by the Wesleyan defender. A little miscommunication, but Spatterford still able to get the pass, but they're going to whistle. They're going to whistle Ben Ferris for the up and down.
A poor turnover.
Joseph Kuo guarded relatively loosely, but still goes for a pass to Jack Mackey. Spadford doing double duty, covering Mackey and BJ Davis there. Some feisty perimeter defense. Davis finds Epps with a head fake, takes a dribble and pops it off the glass to cut the Jumbo's lead to two.
Resilience from the men in blue and the men in red, or white as the case may be.
Here's Ben Ferris. Takes a couple of dribbles. Finds Spadford for the long three, who is nearly going out of bounds. It's going to be a jump ball. Spadford jump is ball. Fired up after that. Fighting with PJ Reed there for the ball. It's going to be Tufts possession.
Returning for Tufts, number two, Tom Pileski.
You can hear from across the gym Joe Riley yelling at his players.
Well, yelling at makes it sound violent. Perhaps he's loudly instructing them.
Pileski with a little bit of an awkward shot. Couldn't really decide whether he wanted to use his right or his left.
And why not both? Well, I'll tell you why not. It didn't fall in.
Plainly ineffective. Davis hits the ball off the foot of Tariq Smith, who's able to get it. Goes down in transition, finds the layup. Ferris can't get the rebound. Going back down the other end is Epps, who finds Mackey. Spotting up for the three, it's no good. Neither is the putback. A little bit of... A little bit of taps going on there. Ball's going to roll out of bounds for Tufts.
Yeah, Smith got lost in the moment. That kind of a play. He didn't have a clean breakaway. He probably would have benefited more from pulling up and is starting a new Jumbo possession. Instead, tried to take a layup that was off balance and not prepared for.
We've got just over a minute left before halftime. Smith is going to get Pileski, who's going to pull up for another three.
Where is this coming from? This is absurd.
Spacing the floor for some Nowitzki-esque threes.
Pileski matching his season total for threes and not even a full period of play. That's not something I expected to see this afternoon.
Pileski's already tough to guard in the interior. So get outside is sure going to make this Wesleyan Cardinals defense run around a little bit. Figure out whether to switch, whether to keep Joseph Kuo, who has been guarding Pileski for most of this matchup, on him as he strays away from the basket.
Well, I have a feeling that's why Pileski is being instructed to take those shots, is to sort of neutralize the height advantage that the Cardinals get from having Kuo in the interior. If they don't even try and go near him, he can't do anything.
Not sure if Coach Sheldon sees that as a bug or a feature of this tough soft. They're up by five. Can't be too harmful so far. They've been going in.
There's nothing wrong with a little innovation.
With the backdoor cut, it's the bandaged man on the court, Joe Edmonds. Smith finds Engvall, who hits a three from the left flank.
And that elicited even a golf clap, even from President Monaco himself, usually of a more stony face.
We have a stoic executive here at Tufts.
Yeah.
Flurry of threes from Tufts. Let's see how Bond are going to have about a second between the game clock and the shot clock, so there is the chance that Tufts may take the last shot of this game.
This half.
Davis finds Rahid Epps, and it's a shot clock violation. Tufts to inbound with 9/10 of a second
shot
on the clock. That shot from Rahid Epps didn't hit the rim, so you hear the buzzer sounding.
And then Jumbos will have a little over 1.5 seconds.
They're going to reset the game clock there, so maybe enough time for a dribble. Certainly enough time for a Derek Fisher-style fall-away three.
The clock has not started.
Vincent Pace launches it from three quarters of the court, able to hit the backboard. So we're going to go into halftime with Tufts 36, Wesleyan 30.
Well, it's been very exciting to this point, back and forth. Cardinals taking an eight-point lead. Now the Jumbos at halftime with a six-point lead is their largest of the game. The key has been mental mistakes late in the half by the Cardinals. It's something that plagued them against Bates. And I'm not willing to say which is the better team on the floor, but the Cardinals are the team that have made a few mistakes, and that's why the Jumbos have a six-point lead. So at halftime, we're going to take a look at the social media scene, answer any tweets that have come in. We're going to take a look at some of the other athletic events going on at Tufts Athletics facilities, and we're going to talk about the game.
Yep.
We'll see you then.
And we're back in action here at our Tufts JumboCast halftime show. It's Bernie Birnbaum. I'm Alex Dobian. Hopefully we've been encouraging you to tweet at us, interact with us on social media. So we're going to go read some of the things that have been sent to us via Twitter.
Let's take a look. CAC Sports Blog says, I must say, Tufts JumboCast does a nice job. Replays and multiple cameras, cutting edge stuff. Well, thank you, CAC Sports Blog. We try this upgrade. We got over winter break, and we've been trying to use all of our features to bring you the best experience possible.
Hopefully you'll see some more tricks from us in the future from our technical whiz, Jake Hellman, directing us today. From Becca_Lynn_13, we have another one from @JennaFried and Bernie's favorite pre-broadcast pump-up song.
Well, they do play pretty much whatever they're playing. They usually have pump-up music on for the teams, and I can be found grooving. Last week, a favorite of mine was Chandelier by Sia. I have a great falsetto.
The PA crew here is a really big fan of Migos. Lots of Versace going on during the pregame warm-up, usually at about the 45-minute mark. Let's see if we can get another tweet here. I know we had one from some Birnbaum family members.
Rich Birnbaum, no relation, I don't think, likes the split-screen benches during the last timeout. Once again, another one of our features. So as I mentioned, we have one of our intrepid camera women, Danny, going to check out the track meet that's going on. Let's see how she's doing. This is the point of view as she walks from Cousins Gymnasium over to Gantcher. Her feet is only as good as the Wi-Fi, so we're stalled a little bit there. You may have noticed that we've had some runners going by every now and again. They're perhaps practicing. Also, I don't think we're going to be able to get a shot, but directly to our left in Carzo Cage, some of the Tufts Quidditch team has been practicing. I'm not sure why that's a sport. Here.
And Danny's still on her way to Gantcher Gymnasium, hoping to show you some footage from the track meet going on there. In the meantime, let's talk a little bit about that first half of basketball, Bernie. What did you like from the first half from the Jumbos, and what didn't you like?
Well, from the Jumbos were playing their brand of basketball, and that's, without Sabetti, that's a lot of outside shooting, interior when you can. Pelleschi doing his best. One thing I didn't like is he's not hitting a lot of the field goals that he needs to hit. But playing good defense and capitalizing on the mistakes the Cardinals have made. It's a very even game, and it should be a very exciting second half.
We saw the Jumbos go on a run there to close out the second half. At one point, they were trailing by 8, but they managed to pull back, turning around by a 14-point margin. They're now leading by 6. So when we get to see some more basketball in the second half, it should be an exciting contest.
Well, no lead is safe, and not when these two teams are concerned. Both teams have had leads at halftime that they've blown. Both teams have come from behind. It's anybody's ballgame right now. Let's see how Danny's doing. Getting a signal from our director that Danny's not doing so great. Perhaps the Wi-Fi is not extending as far as we thought it would.
Normally very reliable on campus. They've got some pretty blazing fast Wi-Fi here, but it's not always the most reliable signal, I suppose. Well, without a camera feed from Danny, we've not got much to show you from the track meet, but lots of runners making their way behind and in front of our cameras around here, doing some warm-ups before the game. Lots of different college shirts you might not see around here.
Some Brandeis, some BSU, I'm not sure, Ball State. I don't know what state starts with B around here, but
Keene State from New Hampshire having a riotous good time. And yeah, well, we're going to, I suppose, be back in action and show you at the start of the second half.
And if we hear from Denny, we'll let you know. I think she might be at Lost. She might be in Middleville, Connecticut by now, Middletown. So hopefully she finds her way back.
Well, maybe she'll run into the Tufts women's team taking on Wesleyan at Wesleyan today. That game starts at 3 o'clock, so.
We'll come back 4 minutes to go until the second half begins. We'll come back a little before then to update you on the travails of Danny and to give you an out-of-town scoreboard and some things to look forward to in the second half. For Adestovian, I'm Bernie Birnbaum. This has been the JumboCast Halftime Show.
We'll see you in a couple of minutes. And we're back here in action with a little under a minute to go before action resumes here at Cousins Gymnasium. It's Alex Dobian here along with my color commentator and partner in crime, Bernie Birnbaum.
We have an update on Danny. We think that when she switched Wi-Fi routers, we lost connection with the camera. And well, she's back with us. She's ready to do the... there's the shot of us now. So the technology's not perfect, but it's a good look at our setup here.
A good shot of the scoreboard there, winding down. What can we expect from the Jumbos and the Cardinals to start this second half?
Well, I expect more good shooting. Both teams over 40%, but the difference has been turnovers. Wesleyan committing 9, Jumbos just 5. And one thing that the Jumbos are going to want to work on, if they can, is they actually trail in the rebounding margin. That's not something they usually do, thanks to the size of Civetti and Pileschi. But so with Civetti out and Pileschi equaled by Kuo, it's not an easy game on the glass.
Yep. Not totally unexpected from this Wesleyan team. They do turn the ball over at the highest rate in the NESCAC. Another interesting stat, Tufts bench is outscoring the Wesleyan bench by 16-9. Able to see some contributors standing up like Tariq Smith, Stephen Haladinha, key players from Tufts who are coming off the bench.
The Kinect Sports Flag asking if there's any information on Sabetti's injury. If you watched our show last night, we did have some wild speculation. Our best guess is that he was injured during warm-ups yesterday. He did not practice the team in the hour before the game and wasn't on the bench either, leading us to believe that that's when he got his brace. Today he was out there during warm-ups just chilling on the bench, and he doesn't have a brace on today, so it seems a speedy recovery. We don't really know the nature of the injury except for it was his right leg.
Wesleyan started the first half with a bang, a big three-pointer from B.J. Davis before a Tufts miss at the other end, so they've cut that halftime deficit in half already to make it 36-33. It's going to be a Wesleyan inbound on their own end as Nike finds Davis. The shot is off the mark. Tufts bringing their starting five back in action to resume the second half as Lapham brings it down the court, finds it Ben Ferris, who likes to cut from the flank to the top of the key. He's going to be fouled. Looks like that is going to be Joe Edmonds whistled for the foul. Lapham to inbound. Spatterford gets the ball to Pileschi, who's hanging out at the top of the key away from his normal zone. Mazden is fouled on the way up for a layup.
Wesleyan foul is on number 00, Rasheed Epps.
Call that on Rasheed Epps.
Already two fouls against the Cardinals in the early going. Good job staying out of foul trouble for most of the first half. Not so much in the first 72 seconds in the second.
Mads didn't miss the first of his shots from the charity stripe there. Let's see if he can make the second. Since we mentioned that both teams had been shooting at one point 100% during the first half, their foul shots have deteriorated. Tufts is going to inbound after it was out of bounds off of a Wesleyan player. Lapham finds Pileschi at the top of the key, fakes the three-pointer. An outside threat gets the ball on the block from Madsden, lobs it over the hoop.
The ball, possession Tufts.
Pileschi has not been good on those mid-range shots, but neither today nor yesterday, and yet he keeps taking them.
Lapham's inbound to Spatterford was met with a hand from Jack Mackey. It's going to be a do-over. Not sure what call on Drew Madsden. Going to bring the ball down the other direction as Joseph Kuo backs up to the basket, finds Rashid Epps, who sizes up the lane, but not before traveling. Kaleshi to inbound. The diminutive Lapin taking the ball up the court. One of the smallest players on this Tufts team at 5'11".
He's barely taller than me.
Significantly taller than me. Here's Spatiford on the wing. Pelleschi with another three-pointer. Uncorking that outside shot at a way above average rate. That time it didn't go. His first miss from three of the game.
It's a bad miss, too. That's what you'd expect. A big man.
It's what we call regression to the mean as Rashid Epps hits the turnaround lay-in.
First 5 points of the half for Cardinals.
Mackey outstretching a hand to intercept the pass from Lapham to Spatiford, but it only winds up back in the hands of Lapham. Tom Pelleschi with another shot from the top of the key. The long two. Gonna clank off the top of the peach basket.
Silly Alex, they stopped using peach baskets a few years ago, actually. We've now got empty bottom nets. Ball goes all the way through.
Game continues to innovate. Lots of improvements in equipment over the years.
Yes, they developed that sometime, I believe.
Davis, unable to find the basket there. Hits off of the rim, now made of metal in 2015. Lapham drives to the hoop. A swatting Joseph Kuo couldn't find the ball, but neither could Lapham, as on the other end, it's Joe Edmonds.
The perfectly executed give and go on the breakaway.
And Wesleyan has opened the second half with a 7-0 run in just a mere 3 minutes and 13 seconds. Gonna get you a view of the Tufts bench there. Looking to retool.
The Cardinal defense has found ways to stymie the Jumbos as we get that split-screen view that our fans love so much.
Looks like an episode of Family Feud with both teams huddling, looking to find their response to the other, hoping to outwit their NESCAC counterparts.
Well, there's a feud all right. It's a one-point game, one of the most exciting games to have graced Cousins Gymnasium all winter.
Some of you may know that the Tufts women's squad is a bit of a powerhouse, currently ranked in the top five in the country, so games are far from close contests. This men's team has had a pretty successful record at home so far, usually able to win comfortably at home, but facing some struggles on the road. This is definitely one of the closest contests we've had so far, especially at this point in the game.
The Tufts men's basketball team actually controls their own destiny. They come into today's game half a game out of first place. Trinity at 5-1, Jumbos at 4-1 in NESCAC. The Jumbos have that one win against Trinity, and if they win out, we'll have the first seed in the NESCAC tournament. It's a long road to get there, though. Half the NESCAC schedule already played, but that means half of it's still to come, including today's game against Wesleyan.
That shot was from Joe Edmonds off the mark. Tom Pelleschi looking like David Turi as he caught the rebound against the top of his forehead, bringing it down to the other end. Here's Ben Engvall, takes a couple of dribbles, finds Ben Ferris, who can't get the shot to go from downtown. Cross-court bounce pass, you don't often see one of those, but successfully executed to Joe Edmonds, who is able to draw the and one.
Say no basket.
Oh, they're going to say no basket.
Charge.
They're going to call that an offensive foul.
No argument from the Cardinal bench. Well, yesterday we saw the Camels fail to score for the first 5 minutes of the second half, and now it's the home team's turn to the scoring drought to open a frame.
Engvall finds Vincent Pace, who doesn't get the shot to go. Going to be marshaled in by Joseph Kuo. Here's Jack Mackey. Around the side, I guess PJ Reed. Mackey backs up of Paladina, hits a bit of a fadeaway shot that isn't able to go through the hoop.
Very suffocating defense from Paladina on that play. If only we could show our instant replay to the refs. That was a very close call. I'm not sure exactly who it went off of.
Rafters gets the ball, passes the rock to Gallivan. Shudeps is going to get whistled for the traveling violation.
And the Cardinals have had a few of those. It's the kind of mental mistakes unforced by the Jumbos that they just can't make in this competitive NESCAC conference.
Refs calling a tight game, penalizing the Cardinals for their lapses in hand-eye coordination as Smith is going to be fouled as he takes the shot. Caromed wildly off the backboard.
That's his fourth personal, fourth team foul. It's turning for Wesleyan, number four, P.J. Davis.
Well, last night, with 12 minutes remaining, Wesleyan had a 9-point lead, and over the course of the next 6 minutes, that lead was squandered. Fouls played the Cardinals and other mistakes. And now with a 1-point lead and 14 minutes to go, the Cardinals will have to play a much tighter game than they did last night.
Paces long two, shakes the backboard. Wesleyan is going to bring it back down the court. It's in the hands of Jack Mackey. Now then. To Mackey.
If you look at the defensive setup for the Jumbos with Kuo off the floor, there was hardly anybody guarding the interior. Pelleschi's on the floor, so the Jumbos have the size advantage. Jumbos not at all concerned about an interior threat.
Engvall was the one whistled for the foul there. Seem to leap onto the back of Rashid Epps.
So Wesleyan's the team taking the timeout despite the Jumbos not having scored for 6 minutes.
Well, since the Tufts timeout, we haven't seen any scoring for nearly the last 3 minutes of action.
We'll take a look at the out-of-town scoreboard. Colby leads Trinity early. 10-8. Trinity the host of that one. And meanwhile at Bates, Connecticut College leads 9-7. Now in all of NESCAC, this is the only game to have started before 3 p.m., so most of the other games are starting within the past few minutes.
Tufts making a decision to push this one back an hour. Later on today at 4 o'clock, Tufts Ice Hockey is going to be taking on Williams.
Yeah, they had a big win last night. Tufts Ice Hockey has struggled of late against a strong NESCAC conference in hockey as well, but this year not taking the league by storm by any stretch, but definitely having improvement. Hanging tough even with some of the best D3 hockey teams there are.
The Little Ivies of the NESCAC are one of the strongest conferences in Division III in most sports.
Football is the exception.
Mackey's going to take the ball here. NESCAC football does have a little bit of a history to it. Amherst and Williams, one of the most storied D3 rivalries in the nation. Tufts also played some important early contests in the history of college football. Notable game against Harvard. That was the first Tufts victory in college football. That was way back in like 1860-something. I want to say 1869.
Might have been a bit after that. When was Tufts founded?
1855. As Joseph Kuo makes the two there. We're wandering off topic here.
Yeah, back to the matter at
as
hand.
As Tariq Smith wanders down the court with the basketball.
Well, the Jumbos have been wandering in a scoring desert. A 9-0 run over the course of the first 6.5 minutes for the Cardinals.
Mazden tries to go up and under, but he's squeezed by two defenders. And on the other end, B.J. Davis misses the easy layup before finding the hoop, picking some Tufts pockets.
He's very fortunate to have gotten that second opportunity. He does not have to return to the other end of the court with his head hung low.
Instantly making up for his mistakes. Driving to the basket is Smith. Doesn't go, neither does Mazden's putback.
And there's a force field around the rim on the western end of the court.
Halladina was whistling for the foul. He was wrestling with P.J. Reed for the ball. Referees decided to put a stop to it and award the Cardinals an inbound pass. B.J. Davis bringing the ball down the court to Reed. Malvin finds Davis. Joseph Kuo inside. Tries to shake Mazden, can't get it, and Mazden is going to take the rebound. Bringing the ball up to Smith. Couple of dribbles. Makes a big three over P.J. Reed, who came flying in attempting to block the shot, but with a high arc, Tariq Smith is able to get the ball to fall, putting orange through orange.
And the crowd relieved that the Jumbos are in fact capable of scoring over the course of the first few minutes of the half. Jumbo's shooting percentage on the game fell from 44% to 32%.
Wesleyan goes wild as Gallivan backed up Drew Mazden, coerced him into a foul, and made the lay-in. With 12 minutes left to go, Gallivan misses the foul shot. It's going to remain a four-point game here. Definitely not out of reach for Tufts, but they've shown a bit of a lackluster start to this first half.
Now it's the Cardinals with the size advantage. Crow on the floor, Pelleschi ready to come back in.
Tufts going small as Halladina finds Ferris. Lots of perimeter threats here for the Jumbos. Engvall catches the ball, cuts back door. Tries to force it in on the reverse lay-in. It's going to be whistled for a foul. It's going to be on Tim Gallivan. From not too far away in East Walpole, Massachusetts.
Five fouls apiece.
Engvall's first attempt is just short.
Turning for Wesleyan, number 32, Joe Edmonds, replacing
P.J. Reed. Steadies himself for the second attempt, and it's going to be good. Got a one-possession game here. Ferris, Dottie Mackey. This is on Davis. Engvall rotates on. Mackey able to find the open shot after being neglected by his defender, but he doesn't get it to go. Pelleschi is able to grab the rebound. Tariq Smith on the wing. Pulls up for another three. Doesn't get it, but Ferris is able to fly in for the rebound. Halladina contorting himself in an attempt to evade some Wesleyan defenders, but doesn't go.
Out of bounds.
Bit of a kerfluffle. And results in Gallivan hitting the floor.
At least 2 points. Possession, the Jumbo's bench were looking for a foul. None came.
Bit of force play under the basket, but fair game, say the referees.
As far as I could tell, it was all ball, just very, very physical.
Ben Engvall in the corner. Gets it to Pelleschi, who backs up Kuo. Tries to go for that lefty hook shot again, this time over his right shoulder. Doesn't get it to fall. P.J. Reed stops to think for a second, mulls over the three-pointer that he does take. Grabbed forcefully by Joe.
Coe's been allowing Pelleschi to take that hook shot, and Pelleschi's been taking it, and he hasn't been hitting it.
Pelleschi, normally one of the Jumbo's leaders in field goal percentage, likes to do most of his work underneath the basket. Mackey, did a couple of dribbles, finds Edmonds in the corner, Davis at the top of the key. And we're going to have another foul called. It's going to be on Tom Pelleschi.
Based on the motion of the official, it looks like he unnecessarily stuck a knee into Kuo, and the next foul against the Jumbos will put Wesleyan into the bonus.
Anything for an edge. Mackey grabs the rebound from Kuo's shot, puts up a floater of his own, doesn't go. He's alone in the corner and sinks the shot. Pelleschi was late to arrive with some help defense. Gonna double the lead. Put some distance between Wesleyan and Tufts. Smith's pass is took by a Wesleyan defender. There's a scramble on the floor.
And some words between Kuo and Pelleschi, and only some responsible teammates prevent it from becoming more than words. That's not Kuo. That's BJ Davis.
Davis and Pelleschi getting into a very heated argument. Not exactly sure what set them off, but
officials warning both sides.
They had some choice words for each other. We could not hear them. We're on the opposite side of the court here.
Here's a replay of the scramble. And it looks like... I'm still not sure what happened. Maybe we can see it again.
Unable to really see what's going on there.
Timeout touch. It's a full timeout.
Let's take a timeout.
See it again.
From our view, it's obscured by Joe Edmonds. What exactly was going on between Davis and Pelleschi?
Based on the replay, while Smith was down on the ground, and at some point it looks like Davis said something, and Pelleschi, who was many feet away, reacted and began to aggress. It's really hard to say without having been there, but this is one of the most heated games either team has played, and it shows in the passion.
Tufts perhaps a little frustrated that they haven't been able to maintain the lead they went to halftime with. Going into halftime, they now trail by six. So far, Pelleschi puts it back.
And Pelleschi was criminally open on that play. Perhaps the Cardinal coaches instructing players to just leave him alone.
Kuo there with a huge slam. A big response from Wesley, and their bench was livid, filled with excitement. Pelleschi drives by Kuo. He gets the end one, setting this Tufts crowd into some vociferous applause.
As they play on the court goes back and forth. Off the court, it's become a shouting match between fans of these two prestigious institutions.
Both teams have some loud support, although for Wesleyan it may be only from their own bench.
There's definitely a few Cardinals fans scattered throughout the stands.
Making the drive up the Mass Pike to come to Tufts. Joe Edmonds signaling for P.J. Reed to come retrieve the ball. It's around to Mackey in the corner, and he hits another big three. Lots of big shots coming here. You can feel the tension in the room. Smith gets Pelleschi, turns around, gets a couple of unlucky bounces on the shot over Joseph Kuo. Mackey's going to bring it back down the court for Wesleyan. Edmonds doubled. Big rejection by Pelleschi, but Wesleyan able to get a hand on it, and Mackey's got the hot hand. Going to need a heat check for the Wesleyan player. wearing number 24 because he's got a couple of three-pointers in the last couple of Wesleyan possessions. Ferris lobs it to Pelleschi, who pistol playing over Joseph Kuo, gesturing towards his eye. Looked like he might have gotten poked there. Saw his head run into the outstretched hand of Joseph Kuo.
Now
we've got a replay for you here. Mackie with the nice dish to Joseph Kuo, rolling to the basket for the slam. That's how you beat Shaq. And here going down the other end, you can see Pelleschi with the response of his own as Davis misses the foul shot there. Smith. We're going to be whistled before the pass to Ben Ferris, who would have had a wide open three-pointer. Madsen is going to check into the game to provide some size. Checking out is Ben Engvall.
Well, 1-1 now for Smith. Both teams reaching the bonus at approximately the same time.
Rasheed Epps is going to check into the game as well for Jack Mackey. He's going to come out after that sequence of shots from downtown that put some distance between Wesleyan and Tufts. Smith hits his first free throw attempt. Sure to please Bernie.
I have not had any complaints with the free throw shooting tonight. Both teams above their average, above the league average. This is, they're not putting up NBA numbers, but they're not NBA players.
We can't expect everyone to shoot like Rick Barry or Steve Nash or any of the other greats that have graced the NBA, as Kuo sees his jumper from the foul line, plank off the rim.
Wesleyan ball.
It's going to be Wesleyan ball after it bounced off of a Tufts player. Davis lobs it into the reach of Epps, who sees it tipped by Drew Madsden. Wesleyan's going to recover after it nearly went out of bounds. Edmund, you hear the slap from here. Referees are going to call the foul. It's going to be on number 12, Tariq Smith. Edmund's to go to the line for the Cardinals.
Pelleschi is the only player on the court right now that's in any semblance of foul trouble. He's got three. He's going to want to be a little more cautious as the game progresses. Now a conversation between the official and the scores table, or perhaps Coach Sheldon. No timeout called, but the coaches are taking the opportunity, as the officials discuss, to discuss as well.
Looks like there's might be some sort of issue with the clock going on. Not entirely sure why the referees have stopped play here.
It looked like Coach Sheldon of the Jumbos was complaining about something.
Both teams are going to go into the huddle. Finally, we get an announcement from the PA announcer that it's a foul on Drew Madsden.
And I think that might have been what the conversation about, exactly who the foul was on. Or the initial indication was Smith. I didn't think it was Smith. Found out being assessed to Madsen, who actually has four fouls. So I misspoke earlier.
He's going to be sent to the bench to be replaced by Ryan Spatterford.
That's out of necessity. I think we'll probably need him in the end game, and Spatterford and possibly hit some threes and get the game closer in the near term.
Spatterford started this game, but playing a bit intermittently. Coach Sheldon likes to rotate some of his stronger players, like Stephen Halladina and Tariq Smith, in after the starting whistle, staggering his minutes among the rotation.
So It's a 7-point game with an equal number of minutes to play.
Spanford finds Ben Ferris to Engvall. Lots of Tufts players on the wing as Spatterford launches the three that sends the Tufts crowd into a tizzy and cuts the lead to four.
That was one of the best plays the Jumbos have had in a while. Good passing left Spatterford wide open. Cool and collected as he takes the tray.
Even as the second half draws to a close, Tufts picking their spots while Edmonds drives to the lane for Wesleyan. Pelleschi is going to be whistled for the foul.
Tufts foul is number two, Tom Pelleschi has four.
But as long as Crow's on the floor, I'm not sure they can afford to take Pelleschi out.
We're going to see Joe Edmonds here going into the line for Wesleyan. He'll shoot two. Makes the first. And makes the second. With time winding down, it's a real possibility that this could end up being Tufts' first home conference loss of the season. Can they muster the will to victory as Ferris launches a three? That's no good. Rebounded by Rashid Epps.
Last season, the Cardinals and the Jumbos finished tied for 7th place in the NESCAC. It was a 3-way tie. And Wesleyan got the short stick and being left out of the conference tournament. This is a little bit of a grudge match.
Tufts improving so far in conference play, finding themselves on the other end of the NESCAC conference standings.
That's true. A win today for the Jumbos would help them exceed their win total from last season. It's an uphill climb.
Smith hands off to Ferris. Gets the pick from Pelleschi. Wesleyan rotations leave Smith open as he's fouled onto the way to the basket. He's going to shoot. 1-1 thanks to the error of Joe Edmonds.
And now both teams at 9 fouls, so next foul coming from either side will mean the double bonus. Over 5 minutes to play.
Turning for Wesleyan, number 24, Jack Mackey. Tariq Smith.
Bit of lazy defense there from the Cardinals, sends Smith to the line. He made the first. Can he make the second? Tufts is really going to need these free throws here. Pelleschi grabs the rebound and is whistled himself for a foul that goes against Joseph Kuo.
Double bonus now for Wesleyan, and even if Jumbo players are going to miss shots, a wise man has said, you miss 100% of the shots you don't take. It's in the best interest of the Cardinals not to put the Jumbos at the line.
Pelleschi can't hit the first free throw. Tufts so far has an uneven record in close games. Earlier this season, they lost by 3 at home to WPI. Lost it by 3 at home to Rhode Island College, but pulled out a 4-point victory at Trinity with some big shots down the stretch.
Yeah, Pelleschi hit a jumper with 12 seconds left that pretty much sealed it. It's a 4-point game now.
And Tufts going with the full court press. The result in a steal for Ben Ferris. He's pushed by Rashid Epps, seemingly unintentionally, but that's still a foul. And he's going to go to the line.
Yeah, Epps looked mournful when he committed that action. It was certainly not his intention, but a good call.
Got a little unlucky there. Let's see if Ben Ferris can have the lead between Wesleyan and Tufts. Doesn't get the roll there. It's going to be at best a three-point lead for Tufts, but they're going to ice the shooter with a timeout.
There's little evidence that that's a successful tactic. And I think that they just want to talk it over, having seen their lead cut from 9 at one point. Now it's 4, could be as little as 3 in a few seconds. 5 minutes left, this is anybody's game. Jumbos have yet to play an overtime game, and last night on the halftime show, I expressed my desire for one.
Well, unfortunately, at JumboCast, we haven't had the pleasure of seeing some extra basketball. The Tufts did go into overtime way back in November against MIT. That was a road loss by 7, so.
Here's Ferris. The Jumbos have gone 3 of 6 from free throws in the past minute.
It's going to be 58-55 with a little over 5.5 minutes to go. Some very aggressive defense, but Mackey is able to find Davis, who hits the three that is off the mark. Engvall tried to come down with the ball. It's going to be a scramble. It's a jump ball.
Possession
Tufts. Going to be a Tufts jumbo ball based on the direction of the possession arrow.
Some of the wackiest play we've seen all season. And towards the tail end of that play, Spatterford was rushing into the play trying to call timeout. Jumbos didn't even have possession. They did win the possession after the jump ball. Just an insane sequence with the full court press. Now a chance to tie the game.
Both teams ratcheting up the intensity as the second half draws to a close. Here's Spatterford, who finds Smith, swings it around to Ferris. And Pelleschi gets a cutting right at Spatterford. Spatterford is pumped as this crowd, and so are your announcers.
This is crazy.
58-57.
And another timeout taken instantaneously by Coach Joe Riley. Two in a row, and looking at the game reset, Jumbos have, don't have a foul to give, and are already in the double bonus themselves. Two timeouts apiece, under 5 minutes left in a one-point game. We could be headed towards some NBA-style grind-it-out endgame. I'm not sure if I look forward to that, but it's always fun to have the excitement in the building.
Foul shooting is going to be a key down the stretch as these teams might look to stop the clock. Especially if Tufts takes the lead, they're going to need to keep hitting those free throws to be able to stave off the opposition.
Not that it's the first thing on any of our viewers' minds right now, but the game going on in Middletown is just a five-point game between the Tufts women's basketball team and the women's basketball team of Wesleyan. The Jumbos lead 29-24 in the closing minutes of the first half. But we've got a very exciting one here at Cousins Gymnasium.
Mackey being guarded by Vincent Pace.
Pelleschi notably not on the floor. He's in foul trouble.
Davis almost didn't know what to do with that pass from Mackey. Winds up in the hands of Edmonds. With a putback from Joseph Kulo to make this a three-point game. We've got a Coach Sheldon opting to take Pelleschi off the floor while Joseph Kulo is playing. So going small for Tufts. Going to focus on the perimeter here as Ferris spots up the three that's short.
That never had a chance.
Mackey bringing the ball back down the court.
The invisible defender almost had the strip.
Loses a little bit of grip there. As Davis hands off to Edmonds. This Wesleyan defense is going to reset, try to burn some clock. A nice block there from Vincent Pace, but no one was there to stop the putback.
And the second that shot went in from Crow, Pelleschi went to the scorer's table. Coach Sheldon knows that foul trouble aside, size advantage is necessary.
With some acrobatics, nice aerial display from Tariq Smith as he makes the lay-in. We're going to get a timeout here.
Timeout, Wesleyan.
Called by Wesleyan coach Joe Riley.
And Riley must have a lot to say. Now the third timeout in just a couple minutes. And only one timeout remaining for the Cardinals heading towards the end game. Well, taking a look at the free throw percentage numbers, these stats, not including yesterday's game, Wesleyan is the second shooting team overall in NESCAC, shooting the 67% free throws. Jumbo's at the middle of the pack, shoot 71%. And it's now a one possession game, 3-point game, 3.5 minutes to play. And unless some ridiculous streak comes off the hand of one of the shooters on the floor, those fouls are going to be key.
Well, earlier we saw a streak of consecutive three-pointers by Mackey for the Wesleyan Cardinals. Yesterday, Stephen Halladina hit a couple of three-pointers in a row for Tufts, so we could see some outside shooting if one of these teams sees a player get a hot hand.
The theme of this half has been anything you can do, I can do better. The Jumbos gave up the first 11 points the half before putting it on them, starting to come back, and as they've chipped away, it seems like when the Jumbos score, the Cardinals come back and equal it. And so the Jumbos have found their way, climbed their way back. It's a 3-point game.
Spadaver chases down Mackey, who finds Davis. Ball ends up inside to Joseph Kuo. It's guarded by Pelleschi, who can't stop the shot from going in. Hits the five-footer. It's Tariq Smith seeking to penetrate. Finds Pelleschi despite the outstretched hand of Joseph Kuo. With the head fake, Pelleschi goes to the basket. Doesn't get it to fall. Tufts is going to stay down by five as we have under 3 minutes left to go in this contest.
Cardinals starting to try and slow the pace. If they can score, make it a three-possession game, the clock will be on their side.
Mackey resets the Wesleyan offense. Shot clock nears the single digits. Mackey finds Edmonds, who looks for the three. Decides to drive. Gets Davis. Edmonds for the three. Hits the rim to reset the shot clock. Going to be a foul called. Edmonds is going to go to the line thanks to the foul by Ryan Spatterford.
Pelleschi almost nearly called in the battle for the rebound. He would have been out of the game.
Coach Sheldon taking a chance here that Pelleschi can stay out of foul trouble down the stretch. Edmonds sinks the free throw.
And if you can see side by side, Kuo and Pelleschi, and there's just a different demeanor. Kuo did, and in the zone, Pelleschi looks nervous.
And Edmonds hits both of his free throws. Back to a 7-point game. Wondering if Coach Sheldon can find the right combination of players to put on this court to narrow this lead.
Tough ball.
Jack Mackey tips the ball out of the play and then dives out of bounds to only push his own deflection out of bounds at a faster rate. Smith with the inbound. Ferris is on the wing. Tariq Smith takes the ball to the back to the top of the key. We just passed the 2-minute warning. Pelleschi gets the ball down low.
He's fouled by Kuo. It's only Kuo's second.
Pelleschi, I don't think, saw Kuo flying towards him as he was facing the basket. But Kuo was not able to time his jump in a way that would hit the ball. Pelleschi hits the free throw.
And any team that's down in the last 2 minutes of a game will enjoy the opportunity to score points with the clock stopped.
Vincent Pace hits the bench as Ben Engvall is back in. Freshman trusted to the big moment. As Pulleschi's shot rolls around the rim and through the cotton. The long shot from Davis, who was fouled a little harshly by Ben Ferris, who was really struggling to catch up to Davis. Had to do whatever he could to keep Davis from hitting the open lay-in. Don't think there was any malicious intent there, but
it's a technical foul called against Ferris for that one. I'm not sure he had a choice but to foul. Perhaps he could have done it in a more reasonable way, but he just wanted to make sure that there's no chance of the ball going in.
Davis hits the first foul shot and the second.
That's his second personal foul.
It was a flagrant two, I believe, and now
Wesleyan
maintains possession.
They're going to get the ball underneath their own hoop with Edmonds to inbound.
A score here by the Cardinals could be the dagger.
Mackey attempts to take on Ben Ingvall.
Ben Ferris
is going to be whistled for another foul.
He was just tired of the shot clock winding down. But it's starting to get out of reach for the Jumbos.
You might have to check the numbers to see who the strongest and weakest Wesleyan foul shooters are. Tufts is going to have to be a bit selective in deciding who they send to the line. And both shots converted by Edmonds. Going to make this a 9-point game. Clock starts as Smith takes possession of the ball. Nearly loses it, but it winds up in the hands of Ben Ingvall. Gets Pulleschi down low, who's double-teamed, but is able to find the basket nonetheless. The large bodies of Kuo, and I believe that was Reed, unable to impede the progress of Pulleschi towards the basket.
Quick foul, another one by Ferris, and now Ferris has four.
Three consecutive fouls on Ben Ferris.
Mackey on the line has two shots.
Mackey, of the players on the floor, is the weakest free throw shooter.
Now an 8-point contest as Mackey looks for his second shot, converts it.
Mackey hits just 56% of his free throw shots, but made both of those.
With a minute left, Smith goes to the lane, gets the lay-in. 7-point game. With a minute left, Davis is going to be fouled. Call is going to go against Tariq Smith. Obvious strategy here by the Jumbos, try to stop the clock. Hope that Wesleyan misses their foul shots and that Tufts can get some points on the other end.
It's a steep hill to climb, though.
Maybe out of other options. Davis hit the first one. And gets the second one to go as well. I think if Tufts is going to look for some more outside shots. Ben Ferris is left open, and he hits the big three. It's going to be a 6-point game, and Wesleyan promptly takes a timeout.
Well, now that it's a 6-point game, Jumbos don't necessarily foul, I don't think. A steal would be great with 50 seconds left in the game.
They may be betting that Wesleyan will turn the ball over, or that they'll be able to grab an errant shot and move back down the court and hopefully hit some shots. We've got about 15 seconds separating the game clock and the shot clock. Wesleyan is obviously going to try to use as much of that as possible. Guessing we can expect to see some full court press from Tufts on defense, playing aggressively.
Now, as far as the Cardinals are concerned, if they can just not commit a foul, they should be able to hold on. If they don't commit a foul, if they don't commit a turnover, and they manage to milk a lot of the shot clock in the upcoming possession, should be able to put it away. But it's still a very close game.
Pulleschi goes to the bench. We got more outside shooters for the Jumbos. Davis outrunning all of the Tufts players to bring it down the court. They're trying to foul. Spatterford able to get the foul on Mackey, probably the player they wanted to foul in the first place. That took about 7 seconds off of the clock.
I'm not sure why Mackey even had the ball in his hands. I'm not sure why he's on the floor, really. They should have good foul shooters out there. Mackey's been consistent in this frame. And now Pulleschi at the scorer's table, ready to come back in.
No complaints from Coach Riley there for Wesleyan, as another free throw made by Mackey. That's at least three in a row for him. Second one, pitch perfect. We're back to an 8-point contest. Spatterford wanted the ball, but Smith is going to take the shot himself. It's not going to go, and Kuo is going to be fouled after snagging the rebound.
Do it. It's an 8-point game. Cardinals. 33 seconds remaining, and Jumbos, they're going to play this one out, but it might be time to start looking ahead.
Jumbo's next game is going to be on Tuesday on the road at UMass Dartmouth. They'll resume conference play on Friday against Hamilton. And the following match against Williams is going to be your next JumboCast broadcast. They're from here in Somerville, Massachusetts at Cousins Gym. Kuo hit the first foul shot there. And he's also going to convert the second. Clutch free throw shooting so far from Wesleyan. Tufts is still going to try to back on the board as Spatterford doesn't get the shot to go. You can see him looking a little dejected there. He really wanted that one, and it really was not that far from going in.
Well, now the 10-point game, the Cardinals set to make the margin even more. The scoreline doesn't belay the true nature of this game. It was back and forth. Lots of streaks going on. Wesleyan took an 8-point lead early. Jumbos came back, led by 6 at halftime. Wesleyan scored the first 11 after the half to take a 5-point lead of their own. And then it was some back and forth. Lead stretched to 9. Jumbos came back, made it a 3-point game before it deteriorated and is now an 11-point spread. Just 25 or so seconds remaining.
And we're going to wonder if Tufts might have done a little better with Hunter Sabetti in the game. We spoke a couple of times about the matchup problems presented by this Wesleyan team. They're a big squad. Tufts has instead opted to go with lots of guards, combos, combo players play the guard or forward position.
I mean, what I think is that Jumbos didn't need Sabetti to win. This was a game that they could have taken control over. They were up by 6 at halftime and taking advantage of the Cardinals' mistakes. That said, you know, if the Jumbos have Sabetti, then it's not just Pulleschi and Kuo the whole game. They can both take breaks, and when there's the 2 6-8 guys out there, it's not as simple of an equation as it is when it's just one-on-one among the big men.
Ultimately, though, you have to hand it to the Wesleyan Cardinals. They did tamping down their mistakes. They've been hitting their shots. They've been shooting much better since they've took the lead over from Tufts, especially in the second part of this second half. Can't say it was not a deserved victory for them. They did everything they needed to do.
And Davis again.
Jump ball. Possession Wesleyan.
The Wesleyan coach is just telling his players, just finish. Davis almost got into it with Spatafford, and 20 seconds left, they just want to go home. The foul called immediately. And Jumbos will need to average over 2 points, or over a point per 2 seconds to tie this game. I'm not sure why they insist on elongating it. Much of the crowd has since given up.
Definitely a marked change from the tension that characterized this game going into halftime and afterwards. The players have calmed down. The crowd is much quieter than they used to be. Kuo misses the foul shot, but it's not going to be of much consequence as Smith brings it down for what could be the final Tufts possession. It's going to be missed. Smith does manage a steal. Spatafford gets an easy lay-in. 1.8 seconds remaining, and this contest is going to be over soon.
The Jumbos played to the final buzzer in the 80-71 loss at home. It's not something that you can usually fault a team for when a game that's so out of control and when there's been emotions flaring. It may have been in their best interest to ease off. In any event, Wesleyan will be back in action at home next weekend against Trinity on Friday night and then Amherst on Saturday. And we already mentioned that the Jumbos will be in action at UMass Dartmouth Tuesday before coming home to face Hamilton and Williams next weekend. JumboCast will be the Williams game on Saturday afternoon. On a personal note, a pretty impressive streak has just ended. I've done a lot of sports broadcasting for numerous sporting teams, men's and women's soccer, football, volleyball, field hockey, men's and women's basketball. And in total, about 25 different broadcasts, and this marks the first time in this school year that I've witnessed a home loss for the Tufts Jumbos. So, an impressive streak. I've refrained from mentioning it on the air until it was over. We can get superstitious about those things. It was close. I did see the Tufts women's soccer team play to a 1-1 draw, but with the final score of 80-71 tonight, it's the end of an era, perhaps.
Normally, JumboCast is a good luck charm for Tufts teams. This football season, we were able to witness all of their victories. We went undefeated at home. We covered all of those games. We haven't seen a basketball loss so far for either the men's or women's teams, but good things come to an end, and so we have to say it's a melancholy time here to watch the Tufts loss today.
Well, the Jumbos fall to 500 overall, 4-2 in NESCAC play. They still stay near the top of the NESCAC standings. Wesleyan takes a big bounce, and I expect that both these teams will be in the NESCAC tournament come season's end. Nobody's locked anything up yet, though.
Well, we look forward to bringing you more basketball next Saturday. We hope you've enjoyed the broadcast. For Bernie Birnbaum, I'm Alex Dobian. Your final score today, Wesleyan Cardinals 80, Tufts Jumbos 71.